there's 260 million people in Indonesia, and about $1 billion of beer sold every year. In Bangkok, when we started, we went from funding the company to selling our first beer in 4 months. In Indonesia, 2 years.
Can you talk about a little bit taxes? And
how much time you got? I could write a book about that.
When I called him up and told him that we were going to get Anderson Valley into Indonesia, he said, "That's not going to happen."
Yeah.
No. I don't care what they say. It's not going to happen. And so when I was able to call him back up and say, "Guess what? We're actually going to ship some beer to Indonesia," he still was like, "Well, we're going to ship it. Make sure you get the money up front."
Hey, what's going on, guys? It's Lydia Wright out here, and I have a very special guest here today.
A business owner here in Bali, Indonesia. The guy who runs a craft beer distribution company,
Aaron Grieser. He runs a Beervana, and we have owner of the Anderson Valley Brewing Company is Trey White.
Yeah, guys, please tell me what's going on and like how's the beer going here?
Yeah, first, cheers.
Yeah.
Cheers. Yeah.
Thanks for having.
Thanks
us
for having us.
Appreciate it.
So I'm the owner and co-founder of Beervana. We're a distribution company that focuses 100% on craft beer. So I grew up in the American Pacific Northwest, which in a little valley called the Willamette Valley. And the Willamette Valley happens to be this magical little place where a huge volume of hops are grown. The biggest production in North America, actually. And it also happens to be the place where the craft beer revolution really began, because these new hops, these modern craft beer type hops, it's really where a lot of them were cultivated. And so I didn't know it at the time, but I actually grew up in the nucleus of the craft beer revolution, like right when it was getting started. And so like when I was growing up, basically craft beer is just what you drank. I never thought of it as anything special until I moved away and went to college in Boston. And I was like, dude, where's a good beer? Like, what's wrong with your beer? And after that, I moved to Germany for a year. And I was in Germany like, dude, y'all's beer sucks. Which was a lot of fun. So,
American.
Always, you know, always good to be a little controversial. But yeah, so started Beervana like 6 years ago, based in Bangkok. And just really, I was working in another job, a professional job, and, you know, had always grown up drinking great beer and brewing beer, and just saw like there was no craft beer in the market. So it was just like, man, there's got to be an opportunity for craft beer here. And so I quit my job, you know, and started Beervana in 2012, and we basically were the first people to bring craft beer to Thailand. The first IPAs ever in Thailand we brought in. It was really incredible to watch it happen, and over the last 6 years, it really grew up to be the most vibrant craft beer scene in Southeast Asia, I think. Thailand has an incredible craft beer scene right now, and it's been such a privilege to be right in the middle of it all as it's kind of grown up, so super exciting. And then Indonesia happened because, my wife is actually from here originally. We met like 17 years ago in college in Boston. But she's originally from here. So I kept traveling back and forth between Bangkok and Jakarta and was like,
there's such an opportunity in Indonesia. Like there's like basically less than 60 types of beer available in the whole country when I first arrived. So we're just like, at my company in Bangkok, our office in Bangkok, we sold 547 different types of beer last year. So
wow.
You think about 60 for the whole country, like we have more than that in our warehouse, you know? So it was just like, you saw a huge opportunity. So we started working on it, and we launched operations about 2 years ago. Started in Jakarta, because it's a harder market to tap into. And now the company is actually pushing into Bali and starting to really serve this market. And we're finding a fantastic reception. So, yeah, it's just kind of our lives.
Most of the customers are foreigners, right?
No.
No? Not at all?
Actually, mostly locals.
Okay.
Which is the amazing thing. So, like say in Thailand, when we started off in Thailand, we were about 90% foreigner, 10% Thai people. 6 years later today, we're about 85% Thai, 15% foreigner.
Wow. It's a full-on thing. That's why like when we started off, we were like, ignore white people. Focus on local people, just do trainings in the local language, like, you know, like do activities, like just get people involved in it, and eventually we'll build the market. And so we did that in Thailand successfully, and now I think we're doing it here. I don't know if you've been to Jakarta,
you have been, I actually didn't like that much city. It's super busy. I got, yeah.
23 million people in that city, yeah. You know? Yeah.
But it's great market, I would say. But great. Also, yeah. I know the Indonesia, it's a Muslim country, and in some of the islands, drinking alcohol is, legal, right? How do you guys are?
Yeah, you know, our biggest thing is to respect the local cultures that we come into, you know?
Of course.
So, not trying to do anything bad, not trying to, you know, convert any people to, like, becoming alcoholic or something. You know what I mean? Like, it isn't about that. We're essentially, we think that there's already a demand in the market for better beer. And those people who already want it, we're trying to get it to them, you know? So, it's quite easy. So, overall, if you look at alcohol consumption in Indonesia, mm-hmm. it's actually quite low on a per capita basis, right? There's 260 million people in Indonesia. And about $1 billion of beer sold every year. Compare that to Thailand, it's 60 million people, so like a quarter of the population, and they sell $6 billion worth of beer. So that's a 30, so the Thailand beer market is 30 times bigger, right?
Yeah.
But the interesting thing is that people in the country don't necessarily drink very much. It's mostly in Jakarta and Bali.
Okay.
So the bulk of the beer market is in these two places, which is actually really good for us, because it's something easy for us to reach. And the consumers tend to be very cosmopolitan and very open, so it's actually really good. So in those places, not a big deal. We will never sell in Banda Aceh. We'll never sell in Aceh. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I have no interest in doing that. You know what I mean? Like, we're not trying to disturb or disrupt anything. It's all about just serving a need of people in the market already. So, yeah.
So the craft beer scene is increasing in here. Like, you guys doing a great job bringing such an awesome beer here.
Thanks.
Improving, like, you educating people, local people, what is a craft beer, and what it's supposed to taste like. That's great. Trey, mm-hmm. question for you.
Yep.
You here on a holiday, correct? Or, like, it's business, or, like?
I would say it's 80-90% business.
Okay.
What happened was, our brewery's been around for about 30 plus years. So it's one of the pioneering breweries in the United States. You know, the craft brewery movement in the United States really started to blossom in the mid-1980s. So it's been almost 40 years now. And I had been in the beer business, but we bought the brewery about 9 years ago, a couple years before Aaron started his business. Mm-hmm. And in my previous career, I had spent a lot of time doing international business stuff, in particular with beer. And so one of the visions we had when we bought Anderson Valley was to try to expand the horizons for the Anderson Valley brand internationally. And literally what happened in Aaron's case, who was with you? Do you remember?
A guy from the first company I ever started,
okay.
One of my friends from my hometown.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Aaron and one of his friends came to the brewery in California. We're about 2 hours north of the Golden Gate Bridge there in Northern California. My brewmaster, Fal Allen, had spent about 5 years working in the craft beer market in Singapore, so he had a familiarity with Asia as well. And we were not really exporting into Asia, except for a little bit of business there in Singapore. And Aaron came in, kind of full of piss and vinegar, talking a big game about how, from scratch, this, you know, we weren't even a kid then, but, you know, this guy thought he was going to be able to start a American craft beer importing company in Southeast Asia. And, you know, Fal and I thought that was an unlikely thing to work. Like, why not? You know,
they were looking at me like, is this kid crazy?
Yeah.
Does he know what he's getting into?
So, but at the time, it was just Thailand. And so, you know, we gave Aaron a shot. And as he was describing, he's been able to grow it from not just Thailand, but also to Vietnam and now Indonesia. One of the cool things about the last 9 years for me has been the opportunity to travel many places across the world and see the evolution of people in Moscow, people in Amsterdam, people in Paris, people in Seoul, Korea, Jakarta,
Rio.
Haven't made it to Rio yet, although that would be a good idea, I think.
Yeah.
People in, you know, Bangkok, Ho Chi Minh City now, and now Bali, who are enjoying craft beer. And one of the things I see time after time is, much like in the United States 25 or 30 years ago, when the idea of drinking a hoppy beer was quite foreign to them, you know, relative to the macro lagers and so forth, it's very consistent throughout the world. Doesn't matter if it's Southeast Asia or Eastern Europe. There is a desire for the better beer. And, you know, kind of getting back to your question about, you know, changing mores and cultures, you know, one of the great things about craft beer is not about more. It's about better. It's about how, you know, quality over quantity. And that's one of the things, you know, there tends to be, you know, tremendous respect for the environment, you know, from on the part of the craft brewers. And I think it really fits into what, you know, a lot of, especially young people throughout the world are trying to embrace in terms of not more, but better, be it for food, be it for beverages, be it for alcoholic beverage, be it for other beverages. And so that's how I'm sitting here today. You know, it's, I had had the opportunity a few years ago to visit them in Bangkok and visit South Korea and visit Singapore. This is my first trip to see Ho Chi Minh City and Jakarta and Bali. And but I see, as I said, I see a lot of commonalities in terms of how things are developing. You know, the thing is, and Aaron knows this better than anybody, the laws and regulations differ by country, okay? And they can differ very, very significantly. And so one of, you know, his primary skill sets and the people at Beervana is to sort out, okay, how to best attack an opportunity given those differences. And some of the differences, you know, make their job a little bit easier, some of them a little bit harder. But, you know, in the U.S., we have state laws that, you know, can be a bit challenging at times as well. But my job as a brewery owner from the United States is to try to understand those challenges as well as we can to potentially adapt what we are doing, be it in terms of the styles of beer we're making, to best suit, you know, be it in the Indonesian market, the Thai market, the Vietnamese market, etc. Yeah, it's time for a drink, I think.
Yeah, cheers.
One of my partners with the brewery is a gentleman who has been involved in the international beer business for 30 or 40 years. And one of his jobs was introducing his brands to markets across the world. Not the, you know, not the Germanys and the Frances of the world, but, you know, frontier markets. And when I called him up and told him that we were going to get Anderson Valley into Indonesia, he said, "That's not going to happen."
Yeah.
I don't care what they say, it's not going to happen. And so when I was able to call him back up and say, "Guess what, we're actually going to ship some beer to Indonesia," he still was like, "Well, we're going to ship it, make sure you get the money up front, because I don't have money." So I, you know, I think Aaron, you know, Aaron and the people with whom he works, you know, deserve a lot of credit for navigating their way through the labyrinth of challenges associated with, you know, and look, Indonesia is not completely unique. You know, Russia, for instance, is very, very tough as well. Brazil, very, very tough. And there's all kinds of reasons why those places are that tough. But yeah, so kudos to the Beervana team in that respect.
Thanks, man. Yeah, so you pretty much said it all. Like, when we started, before we started, I talked to several lawyers, and they were like, "Yeah, forget it." They were like, "Yeah, it's going to be, it's impossible, can't do it, you know?" But I'll say, like, here's an analogy. In Bangkok, when we started, we went from funding the company to selling our first beer in 4 months. In Indonesia, 2 years.
Wow.
It was 2 years.
2 years, oh my gosh.
Regulatory, applying for this, applying for that, pushing, you know, everything else like that. Like, it was an incredible amount of paperwork. And just, like, attempt rejection, apply rejection, until you figure out how it really works, and then to go. We had the additional challenge that we don't bribe, we don't do, like, you know, like, none of the under table stuff.
Yeah.
And so for me, like, we wanted to do honest beer. Honest beer is no under declaration, no bribery, no smuggling, no nothing. So, which is actually quite a challenge, especially for Indonesia. So a couple years ago, about 90% of the liquor that was imported into Indonesia was smuggled. I don't know if you know that, but about 90%. So people considered it relatively impossible to actually bring in alcohol without smuggling. In addition to that, there are only 14 active alcohol importers in Indonesia, in the whole country of 250 million people. So it's actually quite interesting, yeah? And so if you look at Thailand, for example, again, a quarter of the population, there are 350 alcohol importers just in Thailand. So you just imagine that disparity, right? So it's actually quite a difficult environment to get into. But I'm really grateful for, so sorry, we started with those principles of just going, we got to be clean, we got to work harder than anybody else and just really try to make it happen in an honest way.
Right.
And if we can do it, then great. If not, then it's not going to work. You know?
Awesome. Yeah. Well, I've been researching how to start a business in Indonesia, specifically in Bali. And I looked it up, and a lot of problems that people are facing for the foreigners is very difficult to start it because you have to have a local person also have to be involved in your business. More than that, the local person have to own more than 51% of your company.
Yeah.
I assume, well, it's your wife, right? So she's Indonesian. Maybe that's kind of helped, or maybe you just tell me your story. Yeah.
Something along those lines. Yeah. It's good to, the idea is like essentially, we came in and, you know, she knows a lot of people in Indonesia.
Obviously.
And so she made some introductions and, you know, over those 2 years where we were setting up the business, just met a lot of people in the political world, in the business world, in the legal world, in the regulatory world, stuff like that. And over the time, that time managed to put together the kind of dream team of people who could actually make it happen. And so, so without talking specifics, it was like, yeah, we were lucky enough to put together the right team of people. But having a local partner is absolutely critical, having the right local partner, and especially in the alcohol business, in importing and distribution. So for retail, mm-hmm. it's a little bit easier. You can be a foreigner and get a business license under the PMA. You can get a PMA and you can be 100% owner of that company. But your activities are limited to, you know, basically F&B retail, stuff like that. So, so it's actually, it took a lot of work and a lot of networking, a lot of shaking hands and hanging out and drinking a lot of beers. But, you know, we were lucky because we actually found a lot of people who were actually really interested in beer. Like one of our founding partners in Indonesia, she's like Indonesian family from a political background. She's a Wharton Business School grad, and she, like, when she was in business school, she started the Wharton Beer Society, just naturally. And so she was previously working for a big state-owned oil company or a big oil company, and she got bored and quit. And she was like, "I want to do something fun." And then one night someone introduced us, and somebody said the B word, like beer. And we're just like, like all night. So. Yeah, so just little serendipitous moments like that where I think it was Louis Pasteur who said, chance favors the prepared mind. So if you're looking exactly what if you know exactly what you're looking for and you're just out there looking for it, you can hit it, you know? But it's just a matter of waiting until it comes along. So it was kind of like that. Well, started in Jakarta and lived Jakarta for 3 years.
Oh, wow.
And so we got the Jakarta team built up and actually able to operate on its own.
So and you have a big operation. Like.
Yeah, we're about... We're about almost 80 people in Southeast Asia right now. So we're 47 people in Bangkok. We're about 23 in Indonesia and about 6 in Vietnam. We just launched in Vietnam 4 months ago. So we're just kicking off there. And next year we're coming for Singapore.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
So the idea was to be the first company to actually distribute beer regionally. So there's a lot of craft beer distributors in Thailand. There's a few craft beer distributors in Vietnam, in Singapore, in Hong Kong, but no one's connecting all those markets.
Yeah.
So we saw a big opportunity to just get in there and kind of do what we do, you know? So, yeah.
Wow, that's great.
Let's see, yeah, it should be.
I hope your business is going to grow more and more.
Thank you, me too, because that means more good beer for everybody.
Exactly.
More Anderson Valley for everybody.
All right.
Ball Hornet, man. You know, for me, like, it's two different markets, you know. Bintang is its own market, and we love what they do. They're so good at what they do. They're amazing. Like, I really admire those guys. For me, like, we're more like a wine distributor, really, when you think about it. Like, if you look at the market, there's kind of a wine is up here, like, in this ultra-premium area, and then beer is typically quite cheap and volume-driven. And craft beer is kind of in the middle, you know. It's kind of, it has that down-to-earth vibe of beer, but it's got all of the sophistication and elegance of a wine. So like with our teams, for example, when we go into the field and when our teams like pitch beer, we basically train them to sell it like wine. So it's like essentially So the terroir, this is from California. It's brewed in Northern California at a brewery called Anderson Valley. You know, it's like made with like this hop and that hop and like with this process and blah, blah, blah. You know, so much like when you talk about wine, you talk about the grape, the origin, and the vintage, right? So right. Similar with beer, you talk about like the origin, the hops, and the brewer. So, yeah.
So what is for you then the best-selling beer that you have?
Right now, our best-selling beer in Indonesia is Anderson Valley. Summer Solstice.
Nice.
It's awesome. So this beer is perfect for the Indonesian market, I think, because a lot of times for craft beer, there's a bit of a ramp up that happens when you're drinking craft beer. You get used to hoppier and hoppier beers. Mm-hmm. But imagine like the first time that you ever had a craft beer, you had a double IPA. It's unlikely that you would be like, yeah. That you would be enjoying it, right?
Yeah, right.
So like it's essentially we found that Summer Solstice is just this beautiful starting point for people to really begin the craft beer journey, you know, to explore different beers. And so for the market in Jakarta, we find Summer Solstice is just fantastic. We sell tons of it there, man. Like the Jakarta market loves it. So yeah, it's great. It's basically a summer ale, but it's really got a really nice biscuity kind of malt profile. And it's actually brewed with real vanilla as well. And so it has this really nice kind of vanilla cream soda. We call it cream soda for adults.
Yes, we do. Yeah, the Summer Solstice has become, throughout Southeast Asia, really the lead style. And, you know, since, frankly, I don't want to step on anybody's toe, there's really only one season in Southeast Asia.
Yeah, endless summer.
Summer, yeah. So we literally make the beer here. You know, in the United States, we only sell it during, the April through, say, July period. But here in Southeast Asia, we're doing it year-round. And, the other style that I think over time, it's kind of gets to what Aaron's been talking about in terms of you don't go from, a macro lager to, double IPA. But a big style for us in the United States called a goza. And I don't know if you have run into the goza style. But, with all the spicy food, a tart, salty beer like goza, should pair very effectively and deliciously with Southeast Asian food. And so over time, I think that's going to be another beer that maybe people are not at all familiar with right now, but in 5 years, they'll be very familiar with it. And, one of the things we've been talking about the last couple of weeks in my trip here in the area is, are there particular styles that maybe we do in very, very small quantities in the U.S., maybe just some draft stuff? That'd be particularly relevant for what's going on down here. And, we've talked about a couple of different things now. And, that's what I'll go back home next week and start looking into in some more details. So, because, that's every, that's part of the cool things of craft beer is, there are no rules in terms of it's not like we're doing the old German Rheinheitsgebot where we're only going to do X, Y, and Z.
Yeah.
Okay? What the Americans have done, for better or worse, is take some old styles. Goza was an old German style that almost died off, okay? But the Americans have embraced that beer style from a production standpoint and turned out all these different derivatives. And, that's what makes it fun for us is, not being limited by, what people used to do, but
goza is awesome with Asian food too. Because like the food is so rich, and Indonesian food especially, a lot of it's fried and like really heavy and rich and stuff like that. So like the saltiness, the
tartness
just like cuts right through the oils and fats. It's awesome experience.
Yeah, you always talk with food pairings. You talk about it having a hook, or kind of being complementary, or something that's really going to create a contrast. And the Summer Solstice, I think, is working in Southeast Asia because it's complementing some of the sweetness of some of the various regional dishes. The goza, on the other hand, is going to come out with a bit of a contrast. And so we're going to take both of them, right? And the thing with goza, it's a very quaffable kind of style. And it's not high in alcohol. About 4.0% ABV. So, again, you're getting higher quality at the same or even lower alcoholic level than your standard macro lager. So, that's why we're excited. you know, that's why that style for us in the United States has really turned into a big deal. And we do, you know, watermelon flavor, cherry flavor, raspberry flavor, blood orange flavors, as well as just the base Gose style. So,
yeah, I think you're pretty much the number one Gose brewery in the States, right?
I mean, well, depends on how you define it.
Will you go on record saying that?
I mean, we're certainly the best Gose brewery. How about we leave it at that? Okay. But, yeah, to be honest, you know, as far as a brand that calls themselves a Gose, yes. In terms of, you know, some other breweries, they make some beers that are very similar. But they don't call them Gozes. And, you know, there's one or two breweries in particular, Dogfish with Sequench, which is, in many respects, you can consider it a Gose, and they do very well. And, look, we're not big enough as a brewery to be the only guy doing it. We like the fact that we have other people doing it to raise awareness. I'm sure one of Aaron's challenges is, while in certain respects it's fun being the only person in Indonesia importing craft beer right now, it's awfully lonely too. And so he's having to do a lot of education by himself.
Like, hello, we're here, team, we're out here.
And so, I don't want to talk for Aaron, but, you know, at a certain level, he might embrace having maybe one competitor, hopefully one that competed but not very well.
I'll take 10.
Okay,
give it to me.
And so when you're a smaller company, you don't have the big budgets to spend millions of dollars on making consumers aware and educating, and so we need some help. But we can be very nimble, and that's why we can be in a place like Indonesia, where maybe some of the bigger companies aren't, and because we also have patience. You know, it took him 2 years to get our brand and a couple other brands able to be imported in the United States. You know, a lot of breweries, and it's still in relative terms. Everything's relative. In relative terms, this is a tiny, tiny base of business.
Yeah.
Right? Now, he's committed to annual 300% growth rates for the next 20 years.
At least the next volume. 10.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah.
You remember that conversation?
Yeah. Okay. How many beers were we deep on that?
Yes.
It is funny, though. I'm noting that Anderson Valley was the first craft beer ever imported into Thailand,
mm-hmm.
and the first American craft beer ever sold in Indonesia.
Well,
Anderson Valley. Yeah, so it's super pioneering on the front edge of everything happening.
Super
cool.
Yeah. We were one of the very early, we weren't the first, but one of the very early ones in Russia as well. But like I said earlier, it's amazing to me the commonalities in terms of the search for newness and quality that people throughout the world have. And that's what guys like Aaron and Beervana are trying to marry or find those consumers and educate those consumers. And like you said, there's a lot of consumer products and other products that have made a bit of a living off the back of expatriates in various countries. But at the end of the day, expatriates are always a tiny, tiny sliver of the overall business. And if you're truly going to build a business in a country, you have to build it with the local folks who want to embrace the concepts as well. And the expats can help you get started for sure, but that's not who's going to ultimately make the business something truly special.
I've got one point on that too, is that just like the craft beer movement in the United States happened because people were inspired by English ales and Belgian ales and German and Czech lagers and stuff like that,
Yeah.
Like, we're trying to do something original in Southeast Asia too. So, like, right now the idea is, like, let's bring in some of the best beers in the world and give it to people and see what they do. Like, you have no idea, right? Like,
yeah.
But, like, what's going to happen when we unleash the creativity in brewing in Indonesia? A country with 260 million people, a country with some of the richest biodiversity in the world. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Who knows? Like,
and
people are so creative. People are so just kind of, really like thinking like next level on things that, like, I'm excited to see what the next five years is going to happen here with beer. It's going to be so cool.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, it's going to pop off.
It's already popping.
It's already popping, okay.
So last weekend, we just held the Brewing Project in Jakarta.
All right.
Which was a national homebrew competition.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah.
Oh, that's
great. So we got homebrewers from all over Indonesia.
And there were two rules. Number one, you got to be Indonesian. Number two, you have to have an Indonesian ingredient. And every beer was good.
Wow.
Every single beer was good. And the winner ended up being a beer called Jus Koko Pandan, which is basically a New England style IPA. It was a bit of a lower ABV, so I would call it more of a New England pale ale, but basically like a New England IPA with pandan leaf and coconut flesh with a little bit of like Indonesian palm sugar put into it in the boil. Super cool.
So delicious, yeah.
It's a dessert, basically. But fantastic. And so that's just, it is the first time we've ever done it. So
you guys held it?
We organized it, yeah.
Oh, wow. That's
yeah.
great.
Part of our mission is...
I didn't even know that you guys are doing such a great job. Like, I thought you just importing beer and, like, I don't know, making money of it, and that's it. But you have actually... Yeah.
No, who's our marketing person?
He's making money hand over fist.
Yeah, sure. We're making millions selling niche beers to an infant market.
I mean, the other thing that strikes me as somebody is how well-informed the consumers are. In all these markets, you know, and obviously social media and the internet facilitates a lot of that, but you know, striking to hear the questions and hear the opinions on the various styles. I mean, who would have thought, you know, there would be a homebrew competition in Jakarta, Indonesia, where the winning beer would be use local ingredients to make a New England IPA. The New England IPA style's only been around the United States for 3 or 4 years anyway.
Yeah.
Okay? There's still parts of the United States that don't really have many local New England IPAs, but you know, these guys here making these beers, they're all over them. And you know, some of the stuff like Untapped really binds the whole world and creates that sense of community that feeds the mentality to be able to be creative with the beers, whereas, you know, 20 or 30 years ago, that would not have been particularly feasible. And that's what's accelerating this process. You know, it's those dynamics that have to ultimately marry up to the realities of the regulatory environments and so forth. And that could be a sticky process. But, you know, that's why, you know, guys like Aaron and his team are here to work their way through those challenges. And because it's, you know, there is no more dynamic part of the world than Southeast Asia, right? And
sure.
You're talking about a very large base of talented, educated people who, you know, I think certainly Aaron and I feel like they're extremely relevant for the concept of craft beer, be it American craft beer, Indonesian craft beer, Thai craft beer, Vietnamese craft beer. And that's why, you know, companies like ours are trying to participate in that and kind of ride that wave and not be drowned by it in the process of all these
things.
So.
I think that's really important, is like to do something original, and like guys like Trey with Anderson Valley, like it's really cool how they come to the market, not as like a take my beer, just like, you know, kind of a one-way relationship. It's really this kind of two-way thing where like, you know, they want to actually participate and create original beers for Indonesia with Indonesian people, that kind of thing.
Yeah, that's amazing. So, that's great, yeah.
Yeah, that's really cool, man. Yeah, it's been fun.
One more question. How do you... facing the problem of importing the beer in the country? Like, it's always hot and sunny, so lots of people would say, oh, I would rather drink a locally produced beer than imported beer, because, like, I don't know how they've been holding the beer, like,
exactly.
What's the, I don't know, sometimes you can get off-flavored beer and you're like, oh, this is
totally
awesome, right? Like, how do
totally.
I bet you're facing that problem, but,
totally.
Like, tell me more about it.
I'll jump in there because, not to speak for air, but you know, one of the primary things they talked about from day one was a complete door-to-door cold chain, which is to say the beer stays cold from the time it leaves the brewery until it arrives in, not their warehouse, but the customers.
Beyond that, to the glass.
To the glass, right. So there's a lot of different, you know, people don't understand either in America or Indonesia or Vietnam all the different hoops that have to be jumped through in order to create a truly cold chain. So my point is, you know, again, kudos to them. I would say the quality of our beer here sometimes exceeds the quality of our beer in certain markets in the United States because of the door-to-door cold chain. It's the reason people think local is better in terms of quality sometimes is because the local is only going 50 miles in the 90 degree heat, okay? And so, yeah, that's better than going 1,000 or 2,000 miles in the 90 degree heat. But if you're doing a true cold chain, it doesn't really matter if it's 5,000 miles or 50 miles, the beer's going to be fine. Because beer, in most cases, if it's kept cold, it's going to have a great shelf life. And that's how a guy like Aaron and his team were able to overcome the challenge of, okay, beer. Because there's plenty of beers out there that are not particularly well made and or made consistently, where if they're not consumed really fast and consumed, then there, you know, there's going to be issues. And that's what drives that problem sometimes.
Totally got it, yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. Oh, that's great, guys. You did such a great job. But then it's also affect the price.
Yeah, yeah.
I would say, like, let's say a big Bintang will cost here like 40,000 rupiah, which is about $3. Sorry. $3. So that means how much your bottle or the glass?
About 300%, 400%, something like that. That's all.
Yeah. Definitely more expensive.
Got one thing to say on that. You don't sell a Ferrari on discount.
Yes, of course.
So for me, like our sales guys and myself, you know, all of us in a market, like obviously the price point is an issue. But the point is, don't apologize for price. Make it worth it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so that's why we invest so much in cold chain, so much in training, so much in branding and marketing and events like we're doing here tonight, is like, you know, just to like really put the extra effort out there so that people feel like, wow, this is a great experience. So you asked like why we do cold chain. I have two little stories for you. One was in 2003, my first time in Southeast Asia, and my girlfriend and I were in, then girlfriend, now wife, were in Singapore. And I was at a bar in Singapore and they had Sierra Nevada Pale Ale. And I was like, Sierra Nevada Pale Ale, yes! You know, it's just like this amazing moment. I was just like, oh my God, I can't believe they have this beer. And I ordered, I was like so excited. And it came to the table and I was just like looking, I was like, oh, amazing. And then they poured it and it was kind of cloudy and I tasted it and it was like wet cardboard, you know?
Oh, yeah.
It was just destroyed and it was like $15.
Ooh, yeah, Singapore is like expensive.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I was dejected. A second story, it was last year, was in Spain, in Barcelona for the Barcelona Beer Fest. And went to a beer festival and just like was walking around from booth to booth, and there was a brewery there that was run by some American guys. Long story short, they had just come back from Phuket in Thailand. And without even prompting, I was like, hey, yeah, I live and work in Thailand. He's like, oh, I was in Thailand, you know, just last month or whatever. And we were in Phuket and we went to this bar, and they had Deschutes Fresh Grieze IPA. And he was like, he had that same dread that I had when I had the Sierra Nevada Pale Ale. And he was like, and it tasted perfect. And I was like, that's why we do this.
Nice.
That's why we invest in cold shipping, warehouses, cold trucks, building coolers at the venues. Like, you see downstairs, they have our taps here, and we installed those coolers so that the kegs stay cold.
Yeah, I've seen
it,
yeah.
Et cetera, so that's the whole reason why. It's because at the end of the day, the only thing that matters is the beer that's in front of you. And if it's right, and if it's fresh, and if it's interesting, then we did our job, you know?
We need to start growing some hops here. There you go.
Can't. You can't grow hops here. The days are too short.
Days are too short?
Yeah.
That's the problem?
Yeah. So you need to, hops are like grapes.
Mm-hmm.
Like grapes don't really grow very well here because it's the same day length almost all year round. Whereas like in temperate zones, yeah,
so
in the north and south.
Plus you don't have the temperature variability either.
Right.
Yeah.
No, so like you get the winter time where like all the leaves fall off and the days are short and all the energy goes down to the roots. And then the summertime when the days are long from like 7 a.m. till 9 p.m. and they just grow all day. And that's how you get the big juicy hops and big juicy grapes.
So, unless you get a greenhouse.
Yeah, unless you have like some grow lamps or something, which would be some very expensive hops.
You start growing other anyways.
No. You get executed for that here, okay? Like, I'm not messing around with that.
Sorry.
The ingredient import side, we're learning a bit about it now because I think it's going to be quite interesting in maybe a couple years' time. I know of a couple different brewing projects that are kind of in the works right now.
All right.
There will be, if you look at Indonesia's craft beer scene today, and just do a cross-section of time, and then fast forward 3 years, it's going to be almost unrecognizable. I think in 3 years' time, there's going to be at least two, maybe three, really vibrant local craft breweries who are doing really cool, interesting stuff. Pretty interesting. Yeah. So there will need to be ingredient supply, but the challenge for Indonesia always is importing and exporting, because the import process is so unpredictable, I'll put it that way. Very unpredictable. So, yeah, so that's the challenge.
If you did enjoy this video, make sure you leave it a big thumbs up. Subscribe to my channel, and I will see you guys in next episode.